We're here in the Miriam Park playground. Kids play here lots of times without any grown-ups being around. Imagine the kinds of things they talk about when they get together. Kids love to tell disgusting, gross-out stories full of bodily humor and all kinds of fluids. The Bible has gross-out stories, too. For the next hour, our focus is going to be the story of the Israelite chieftain Ehud and how he outwitted the evil king of Moab, whose name was Eglon. Ehud didn't hold any formal government office in Israel. He was considered what they call in Hebrew a shofet, usually translated in English by the English word judge. But judge doesn't really capture the idea of the term because it wasn't a legal position. He didn't work in settling cases. Rather, he was a military chieftain, a leader in battles.
Was he a government official?
No, there really weren't any government officials in Israel at the time. Rather, Israel was ruled by a system of elders.
Elders?
Yeah, elders. As far as we know, there was a three-tiered system of leadership in Israel at the time. And elders ran each of the three tiers. At the bottom, and probably most important, there was the extended family unit, again, ruled by elders. Next up would be a clan, extended clan made up of a number of families. They too would be ruled by elders. And finally, on the tribal level, there would be elders that would rule the entire tribe.
But don't we hear so much about the Israelite kings?
Well, the kings came much later. At this point, there was no centralized monarchy in Israel. When the centralized monarchy did come, much later, everything changed.
How so?
The differences between tribal Israel and monarchic Israel are as follows. Whereas under a monarchy, Israel had a single, powerful, central leader, under tribal Israel, there was no centralized government.
This is the door of the office of Thomas Mega, professor of history at the University of St. Thomas. Let's go in and see if he can tell us anything about the Articles of Confederation.
Come in.
Tom, you're here.
Good to see you.
Good.
Yeah.
Tom, we're doing a project on Old Testament history, and there are some parallels between the Old Testament and some early periods in the history of the United States. I was wondering if you could tell us some things about the Articles of Confederation.
Well, sure, David. I think it'd be fairly easy to do. As you know, the Articles of Confederation was the first attempt at a central government after independence was declared. And a lot of what's in the Articles of Confederation really was in reaction to what was happening to the colonies and the colonists in the last days of the colonial period.
How independent or autonomous were the colonies when they confederated in the Articles?
Well, and that's one of the keys to helping us understand what's there, is they feared and were very much afraid of a centralized government. And so the states under the Articles of Confederation were really the sovereign bodies. And this was because they didn't want to happen to them what was beginning to happen to them under the king.
So they were against a strong centralized government.
They were at that point. Yes, they certainly were. And the really important constitutions at that period was not the Articles of Confederation, but rather the each individual state constitutions.
How did they raise armies? Was there a centralized army or taxation?
Well, there was George Washington's Continental Army, that was basically volunteer. Most of the fighting during the Revolution was done by the state militias, which was their equivalent, our equivalent nowadays is the National Guard. But they were under the command of the states. They would volunteer to serve for a while under Washington, but basically a lot of not animosity, but jealousies among the states. So the army there was very... that too was very decentralized.
So what actual power did the centralized government have?
Well, they had some powers. They did have the power to negotiate treaties, for example. So they would negotiate a treaty with France. That particular alliance was negotiated by the Continental Congress. They had the power to go into debt. They had the power to borrow money. So they borrowed a lot of money, for example, from Dutch bankers. Mm-hmm. But basically, very, very limited powers.
Well, Tom, it's always good to hear from an expert on these things. I thank you very much.
You're welcome, David.
Whereas under monarchy there was a professional standing army that served the king, under tribal Israel they defended themselves with a volunteer militia called up by the individual tribes. Monarchic Israel was rigidly hierarchical, that is, with strong divisions both economic and social between the various classes. Tribal Israel was roughly egalitarian, with no true class structure. Kings usually supported their palace and bureaucracy through forced taxation of the people, while any unified actions of the tribes would be based on contributions.
I've arranged to meet here today with Dr. David West, professor of anthropology at the University of St. Thomas. I think I hear him now. Thanks for coming. Dave, I have a few questions I want to ask you about tribalism in a general anthropological sense. Could you start off by telling us how you, as an anthropologist, would define a tribe?
A tribe is the form of social organization that usually comes when societies start doing agriculture, so they have larger numbers. You get beyond the just strict family, extended family kind of band society. So it's an early form of social organization.
How is power arranged and structured in a tribe?
Tribes have a very informal power structure. The elders of the tribe or people with authority in the tribe are always constantly changing, usually in response to some kind of perceived social need. So in a time of warfare, for instance, a strong military leader might be the leader of the tribe. In other times it might be someone with agricultural or survival expertise, someone who knows how to grow the crops, and so people with that kind of knowledge.
How are elders chosen?
It's always a kind of a meritocracy. You have to exhibit an ability to lead. You have to exhibit the expertise that's necessary.
We know that, at least in the Israelite tribal system, it shifted, it changed from tribalism to some other forms. Why do these kind of shifts take place?
Usually it is abundance of resources. People get greedy. As soon as tribal societies come into play when people are just first starting to do agriculture or animal herding. So there's a surplus of food. It allows the population to grow. But it also brings into play for the first time this issue of who controls these excess resources. And so the issue of who controls that surplus becomes more of a social issue. And that's the point in time where someone has to assert a very strong claim to why I should control these. And so you start to get the monarchical systems where, yeah, I should do it because my dad did it. Or I should do it because God wants me to do it. Or
Then the society begins to shift.
And then they become a chiefdom, and then it's a short step from there into a more central state society.
Well, I have one more question, and this is of personal interest to me. Of the different kinds of cultures and societies that you've studied as an anthropologist, how would you evaluate the tribe? Do you like the tribal system better, or do you like some of the more centralized and urbanized systems better, and why?
Tribal system is actually far more persistent than people give it credit for. Tribes survive even in the midst of state societies.
For instance?
Youth gangs, motorcycle gangs, hippies. We see all kinds of tribal kinds of societies where people adopt the particular kind of style of dress or body modifications, scarification, tattoos, piercings, things of that sort. So tribal society is far more egalitarian. It is probably more persistent. It's less susceptible to corruption than most other forms of government. So I guess I would have to, as a romantic anthropologist, go for the tribes.
Well, thank you, Dave. I appreciate that very much.
You bet.
tribal Israel was ruled by elders. Where does the Shofet fit in?
Well, you see, there wasn't any mechanism for more than one tribe to work in concert. So if there's any kind of threat that involves something beyond the tribe, that involves all of the tribes or just a few of the tribes, there wasn't an intertribal council. So a Shofet would arise from among the people who would have the authority to rule over more than one tribe in a time of national emergency.
Appointed by the elders, or perhaps the elders themselves would take this position?
No, they were not appointed by the elders, and in fact anyone could be a Shofet. They did not have to be an elder to be a Shofet. A Shofet could be old or young, male or female, rich or poor, and it didn't matter. As long as the people recognized this person as a Shofet, they were followed as leaders.
But how did the people know if such an individual were called by God? After all, any individual could claim to have heard God's voice commanding him or her to lead. Why should the average Israelite believe such a claim?
Well, that's exactly the problem. There are any number of individuals who claim to be called by God to lead, and they were horribly incompetent and did terrible damage. But there was a feature, a characteristic of people that others recognized that made them leaders, that made others willing to follow them, even willing to die for them. And that quality, that characteristic is charisma. Charisma, 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 charisma. I can remember going to New York on a vacation with my wife and taking the subway into Manhattan to see a play. We went to the play, we enjoyed it, but when we came out of the play, the streets were absolutely packed with people. And there was a level of excitement running through the crowd such as I had never seen before. We grab somebody, we stop them, and we say, "What's going on?" And they said to me, "Don't you know? Elizabeth Taylor was in that theater.
Just let me look at you."
And she was watching the play. And we're all waiting here. We're waiting for Elizabeth Taylor to come out of the theater so that we can see her. So my wife and I decided to stick around and see what we could see. Well, as luck would have it, we happened to have been pushed and jostled by the crowd just so that we were standing right in front of the stage door. Suddenly a big black limousine pulled up, some beefy looking men opened up the doors, and the crowd parted, leaving room for the door to open and Elizabeth Taylor to walk slowly towards the car. She stopped in the middle, she turned around, and she smiled at the crowd. And she was beautiful. And then she walked into the car and she drove away. I learned something about charisma that I have never forgotten, because that woman radiated charisma. That woman dripped charisma. I'm certain that if I was in a room with my back to the door and she walked in, I would feel the radiation of charisma coming out from her. I could remember once when I was a kid, going down the block to a rally, a political campaign, where John F. Kennedy was campaigning for president.
2 years ago, I said that, introduced myself in Paris by saying that I was the man who had accompanied Mrs. Kennedy to Paris. I'm getting that somewhat that same sensation as I travel around Texas.
And I remember how excited I was to actually be able to see somebody so famous. Charisma is important in our culture. Movie stars have to have charisma, musicians have to have charisma, and politicians certainly have to have charisma. We all have memories of concerts we've been to where the crowd went absolutely wild in the presence of some famous and qualified musician. And I could remember in the presidential campaign, the wimp factor, and how very important it was for each politician to prove in some way or another that he or she was not a wimp.
This is where I work, too. This is not showbiz. This is...
In our culture, it's very important to have charisma, but we don't theologize it.
So Ehud is the charismatic leader who saves the day.
Yeah, one of many that you find in the book of Judges.
The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord strengthened King Eglon of Moab against Israel, because they had done what was evil in the sight of the Lord. In alliance with the Ammonites and the Amalekites, he went and defeated Israel, and they took possession of the city of palms. So the Israelites served King Eglon of Moab 18 years. But when the Israelites cried out to the Lord raised up for them a deliverer, Ehud, son of Gera, the Benjaminite, a left-handed man.
This doesn't sound like an exciting story of heroic exploits.
Well, that's because the story hasn't begun yet. What we have here is an introduction that's provided by the Deuteronomic historian.
The what?
The Deuteronomic historian. This is a figure who was writing later and used these older stories, providing a new introduction and conclusion for them.
Why would he do that?
Well, the Deuteronomist is writing at a time of severe national crisis, when the very existence of Israel is being threatened. You see, at that time, the people are really beginning to question and doubt whether God even cares about them, or is willing to save them, or is willing to keep his promises. The Deuteronomist is using these stories, providing a new introduction and a new conclusion, in order to argue that the crisis they're facing is not God's fault, but their fault. This is the Hamline University weight room, known as the Pit. I've arranged to meet here with Tim Polk. Let's see if he's here. Tim Polk is professor of religion, Hebrew Bible, at Hamline University. And let's see if we can talk to him. Tim?
Yo, Dave.
Hi. Don't kill yourself there, Tim.
I'll try.
Ah. Have his...
How you doing?
Hi. Good. Tim, I have a project going here, and I want to pick your brain. Could you tell me a little bit about the Deuteronomist, or as we might call him, the Deuteronomic theologian?
Well, I can try to put together a couple of notions about the Deuteronomic historian or theologian. Well, just as the Yahwistic writer was collecting old stories, so the that tradition stream that crystallized finally in the Deuteronomic literature had been collecting and working on and transmitting stories, pieces of literature that were part of its tradition.
Okay, comment on something I've been saying to my classes about this, which runs a little bit different than this. I see the Deuteronomic tradition as reflecting a position after the destruction of Jerusalem, saying that the destruction was not God's fault, but was rather the fault of the Israelites for their unfaithful worship, that it was, in essence, an effort to get God off the hook at a time when it would be most apparent that it would be God's fault, that God had somehow failed Israel in the destruction of Jerusalem in 587. Would you either disagree with that or fit that in some way? How would you, what would you do there?
I'd try to fit it in. No doubt there is an exilic edition of the Deuteronomic history, but like we were saying, this is a literature that had been in process for three or four centuries, so there are different crystallization points of it. There are different editions, no doubt. Now, in terms of the covenant theology, which goes back to Moses' tradition, the Deuteronomists are tradents, transmitters of northern Mushite, we would say, Moses' covenant tradition. Mm-hmm. Which, and their tact was always to explain Israel's successes and failures in terms of covenant fidelity. When Israel experienced success, when Judah, Israel experienced success, it was God's blessings on them for obedience. We have successes in the period of Jehoshaphat, the period of Hezekiah, the period of Josiah.
So the argument of the Deuteronomist or the Deuteronomic literature at that time would be that God had blessed them because of their covenant faithfulness.
Because of their covenant faithfulness. And accordingly, when disaster strikes, it's because of their covenant infidelity.
So if I may summarize, and then I want you to comment on my summary, the Deuteronomic literature went through a long process of development. You mentioned three centuries, developed by people who had specific political interests in supporting one regime or undermining another regime, culminating finally in this what we might call exilic or post-exilic argument that the destruction of Israel was not the fault of Yahweh, but rather the fault of the Israelites for their religious unfaithfulness. Would that kind of capture it?
No, exactly. Right on.
Okay.
Right on.
Thank you very much.
You bet.
Appreciate your help.
My pleasure, David.
The following books are part of the Deuteronomic corpus: Joshua, Judges, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings. They are thought to proceed from the same author because they contain similar style and vocabulary and a similar theological concern. This theological concern might be described as justifying the ways of God to the Israelites at a time of grave national crisis. The Deuteronomist used oral and literary sources to create his work.
The sequence used by the Deuteronomist to mold older stories for his purposes is almost always the same. The stories are introduced in the following manner. First, Israel sins. Then, Israel loses battles. Next, they cry out to the Lord. And finally, the Lord raises up a deliverer. Please note how Judges 3 follows this pattern. The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord strengthened King Eglon of Moab against Israel, because they had done what was evil in the sight of the Lord. In alliance with the Ammonites and the Amalekites, he went and defeated Israel, and they took possession of the city of palms. So the Israelites served King Eglon of Moab 18 years. But when the Israelites cried out to the Lord raised up for them a deliverer, Ehud, son of Gera, the Benjaminite, a left-handed man.
This was a time of unimaginable defeat for the forces of Israel. When two nations fight, it is understood that the gods of those nations were locked in battle. If one of those nations wins, well, that means that the god of that nation has somehow become more powerful than the god of the nation that lost. Well, that works very well for Israel when you speak of the Exodus, when Israel won a battle against terrible odds against the Egyptian Pharaoh. Well, then Yahweh must be a very powerful God. But what happens when Israel suffers a terrible defeat? It plunges Israel into a terrible crisis. Questions arise in the minds of Israel. Where was Yahweh? How come we lost? What's wrong? And the obvious conclusion, when Israel did lose a terrible battle against the Babylonians, when they were taken slaves, when their temple was destroyed, well, the obvious conclusion then was that Marduk, the god of the Babylonians, was more powerful than Yahweh, the god of the Israelites. Now, you can't hold to a position like that for a terribly long time without concluding that you should be worshiping Marduk instead of Yahweh. And that was the theological crisis to which the Deuteronomist was writing. The Deuteronomist wanted to offer an alternative explanation to this crisis. One may conclude that Yahweh was weak, that Yahweh was absent, or that Yahweh was changeable, or most frightening of all, that Yahweh was cruel. All of these are options. But the Deuteronomist feels that if any of these options is accepted, then Israel is over as a nation. The Deuteronomist wants to offer an alternative explanation. Yahweh didn't violate the covenant. We, Israel, violated the covenant. It's not Yahweh's fault that Israel was destroyed. It's Israel's fault. This is the message of the Deuteronomist. This is the essential argument of the Deuteronomist, that it's not Yahweh's fault when Israel suffers misfortune. This can also be expressed in terms that I like to call the law of retribution. This is a fundamental religious idea. Sometimes they speak of good and bad nations, sometimes good and bad individuals, but it pays to be good. It pays to be faithful. If you're bad, you will always suffer. There is a wonderful balancing system built into the universe, and God enforces it. This is the Deuteronomistic historian's central message, that it's not Yahweh's fault when Israel loses. It's Israel's fault.
But when the Israelites cried out to the Lord raised up for them a deliverer, Ehud, son of Gera, the Benjaminite, a left-handed man. The Israelites sent tribute by him to King Eglon of Moab. Ehud made for himself a sword with two edges, a cubit in length, and he fastened it on his right thigh under his clothes.
We see some strange details in this story. Why are we told that Ehud is left-handed? And what about that sword? How long is a cubit?
Well, I'll try to explain. A cubit is a length from the inside of the elbow all the way to the tip of the middle finger. So you can see what we're talking about here is not a very long sword. It's more like a long dagger. And you could be sure that details like this are going to be important later on in the story. A right-handed soldier would necessarily keep his sword on his left side, so if it was needed quickly, he could bring it out in one smooth motion. If he were to put it on his right side, it would be very awkward to try to get it out quickly if he needed to. Ehud, however, was left-handed, so he puts the sword on his right thigh underneath his clothes. All of a sudden, we know why the sword has to be short. He is bringing in a concealed weapon to the king. What percentage of people in the world are left-handed? Around 10%. It's a very small percentage. If you're right-handed, you put your sword on your left side. The fact that his sword is on the right side, which is impractical for 90% of the people, maybe even 100%, because they tended to train left-handed people to use their right hand. Left-handedness has always had a negative connotation in culture. The word for left-handed in Latin is sinister. The word for left-handed in French is gauche. They always are very negative terms as it passes from language to language. So, if there were guards, they would frisk the left side and not the right side. The fact that Ehud was left-handed and that he used his short sword concealed under his clothes enabled him to enter the king's presence with a concealed weapon. Then he presented the tribute to King Eglon of Moab. Now Eglon was a very fat man. When Ehud had finished presenting the tribute, he sent the people who carried the tribute on their way. But he himself turned back at the sculptured stones near Gilgal and said, "I have a secret message for you, O king." So the king said, "Silence," and all his attendants went out from his presence. Then Ehud came to him while he was sitting alone in his cool roof chamber and said, "I have a message from God for you." So he arose from his seat. Then Ehud reached with his left hand, took the sword from his right thigh, and thrust it into King Eglon's belly. There was one guy in my college judo class who had an enormous fat gut. And no matter what he did, his karate uniform, his judo uniform, could have opened up and his belly would just kind of hang out over the white belt. And once I was partnered with him, and sure enough, I grabbed his collar with one hand and I grabbed his sleeve with the other and I put my bare feet against his enormous belly that was hanging over the belt and I backed up to throw him. And I can remember it as if it was yesterday. I looked up as I was in the process of throwing him over me and his belly had completely engulfed my bare foot up to the ankle. And then when I threw him backwards behind me, his belly released my foot with a loud sucking noise.
We're here at the North Star Martial Arts Academy. As you can see, it's raining outside, and we're going to ask Michelle Holtze to demonstrate some judo moves for us. Michelle, I took judo in college and didn't get very far with it, but I learned a throw that I really liked, and I want you to demonstrate the throw for this video. And in the throw, the person would grab the lapel with one hand, with the other hand that, then lift the foot up on the belly and roll the person over backwards. So if you can demonstrate that to us, we would be very grateful.
Okay, well, Barb and Joel know this throw, and it's called Tomonagi.
Tomonagi.
Yeah, which actually means circle throw, but a lot of people call it stomach throw for the very reason you're talking about. And what happens is she's going to tuck underneath and use her body weight. So even though she's smaller, she can swing under him and get the momentum she needs.
Okay.
So, Barb,
go for it. Can I try it now?
If you take off any hard objects, watch whatever. And
the microphone?
Yeah, microphone.
Okay.
The biggest thing is think of being a little comma as tucking under rather than falling flat on your back. What happens is if you walk him back and he pushes back on you, that's when you tuck under because you're already using his momentum.
And,
so the last piece is step to center, hang on, swing in.
Step to center. Okay. Are we holding? Are we going to move?
Whatever you would like.
Okay, move. Okay, okay. Let's try your way. Okay. One, two, three.
Michelle.
One, two, three. Slide to the center and then go back. Let's try throwing this.
Okay. Let me back up.
Yeah,
just
okay.
A little bit more.
Okay.
So start with this one.
Okay. So one, two, three. Slide to the center.
Yeah.
You want to try that again?
The hilt also went in after the blade, and the fat closed over the blade. For he did not draw the sword out of his belly, and the dirt came out. Then Ehud went out into the vestibule and closed the doors of the roof chamber on him and locked them. After he had gone, the servants came. When they saw that the doors of the roof chamber were locked, they thought, he must be relieving himself in the cool chamber. So they waited until they were embarrassed. When he still did not open the doors of the roof chamber, they took the key and opened them. There was their lord, lying dead on the floor. Ehud escaped while they were delayed.
A small sword went in, and the fat folded over it, and the dirt came out. Now, what dirt? The contents of his large intestines. Poop. How could Ehud have escaped the king's chambers without getting caught? That's what we're about to find out. The king is lying in a pool of his own liquid feces. Then Ehud went into the vestibule. He locked the doors from the inside. He must be relieving himself. Why did they think that? It was the smell. The stench must have been amazing. The faces they would make to each other because they knew what the king was doing. The theory is that Ehud went out through a hole in the floor. Just think, how long would the servants wait before they realized that something was wrong. They waited until they were embarrassed. I'm a theologian. If I were a scientist, I would perform scientific experiments. Psychologist, I would perform psychological experiments. But I'm a theologian, so I perform theological experiments. We're here at the McCarthy Gymnasium on the South Campus of the University of St. Thomas. And inside is a day camp. Now, I'm attempting to reproduce a theological experiment that I made on my children one day. I announced one day that I was going to tell them the story of Ehud and Eglon. My wife's grandfather, who was there, said, "Oh no, don't tell them that story. You'll give them terrible nightmares. You'll damage their psyche." I said, "I want to try it." Anyway, I've gathered together here today a group of McCarthy day campers, and I'm going to tell them the story of Ehud and Eglon and see what happens. I warn you, though, I'm a professional. Don't try this at home. How do stories usually begin when somebody tells a story? Once upon a time. Once upon a time. Kids, I'm going to tell you the story of Ehud and Eglon. Now, first I want to tell you about Eglon. Eglon was a king, which means he wore a crown, because kings wear crowns on their head. That tells everybody else that they're a king. And because he was a king, he sat on a special kind of chair that's called a throne. But there's something else about King Eglon that I think you ought to know that's very important, and that's that he was very, very fat. He was enormously fat. He was so fat that he was the biggest person in his whole kingdom. And you know why he was fat? Because he had lots and lots of money, and he used all of his money to buy food, and he ate all of the food, and he didn't share it with anyone else, so everybody would know that King Eglon had the most food and was the biggest person in the kingdom. And there's one other thing you need to know about King Eglon, and that's that he was really, really mean. He was so mean, he'd get his soldiers together, and they would go into another country, and they'd take over the other country, and he'd tell all the people in that country to give me all of your money, and give me all of your food. And the people would say, "But if I give you all of my food, then I won't have any left to feed my family." King Eglon said, "I don't care about your family. Give me all your food." And the people had no choice, because if he didn't give them his food, they wouldn't have a life. Eglon would kill them. So they took all of their food and all of the things they had that they loved and had value for them and brought them to King Eglon, and he would keep them. And King Eglon, mean King Eglon, what he did was he went into a country called Israel. This happened a long time ago. And the people in Israel, just like everywhere else, they had to give King Eglon all their money and all their food. And there was one man in the country of Israel who didn't want to give mean King Eglon all of his food and all of his stuff. And he didn't want that any one of his friends or his neighbors would have to give King Eglon all of their money and all of their food. So when he put all of his food on a wagon, he brought something else too. He brought a dagger, a short sword. And he told somebody who made this, "When you make this sword, I want you to make it sharp on this end, sharp on this end, and really sharp on the top." And the sword maker made this really sharp sword. Want to try it? Ooh, careful, it's really sharp. Don't touch it. Don't grab it. Ooh, very sharp. It is too, make believe. It's, ooh, don't do that. You'll cut your hand. One more. No, afterwards we'll try. He made a sword with two sharp edges and a pointy tip, and he put it under his clothes. And when he loaded the food on the wagon, he took this sharp sword and he put it under his clothes on his right side. And he came into King Eglon's throne room and he said, "Oh, great King Eglon, I have a message from God for you." And King Eglon, who loved secrets, stood up and said, Everybody get out of the room. Everybody get out. And they were all afraid of him because he was mean, and they all ran out. And then when he was all alone with Ehud, Ehud came up to him and took the sword out and said, "This is the message I have from God," and stabbed King Eglon in the gut. Ehud stabbed King Eglon in the gut, and he fell down and he fell on the floor and died. And he lay on the floor and died. Now Ehud wanted to get the sword out, but the fat around his belly had opened up and swallowed the sword. So he locked the doors from the inside and ran away to get his friends. Now, something else happened. You can sit down now. Something else happened when King Eglon was stabbed in the gut and the fat in his belly swallowed over the handle. Something else happened. Out of a hole in the back spilled all his poop. And when all the poop went spilling over the floor, it smelled a certain way. How did it smell? Ooh. Terrible. And so two of King Ehud's servants, waiting on the other side of the door, smelled something terrible. And they looked at each other and they said, "Ooh, we think the king is pooping." So they waited outside. And they waited and they waited and they waited until they couldn't wait any longer. And then one of them said, "We better go in there. Maybe he needs some help." And the other one said, "Oh no, this King Eglon would be mad at us." And finally, they just couldn't wait any longer. "We're just going to have to do something. What if King Eglon is sick and needs our help?" So they got the key and they opened the door and came in, and there was King Eglon lying on the floor dead in a puddle of poop. But they didn't see any sword because the fat of his belly had swallowed up the sword. So they didn't think a bad guy had done it. Instead, they just thought he'd gotten sick and died. So while they were all meeting together and saying, "Oh, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? King Eglon is dead," Ehud got all of his friends together and they came into the city and they kicked them all out. And that's the story of how Ehud made the cities of Israel free from mean King Eglon. Let's give a hand to our two helpers this time. Thank you very much. Well, there you have it. The experiment was a wonderful success. The kids absolutely loved the story. And the presence of bathroom humor in the ancient Israelite scriptures is proven. The Israelites loved to hear stories that made their enemies look foolish. But even more, I believe they loved to revel in the juicy, smelly gore, the gross-out qualities, the sheer silliness of the whole thing. And apparently, things haven't changed all that much.
The Deuteronomic historian takes these disgusting stories and refashions them to give them a moral lesson.
In the words of the poet Anne Sexton, "This is the tale which I have told. If it be sweet, if it not be sweet, take somewhere else and let some return to me." Peace.
That's the way the stomach rumbles. That's the way the bee bumbles. That's the way the needle pricks. That's the way the glue sticks. That's the way the potato mashes. That's the way the pan flashes. That's the way the market crashes. That's the way the whip lashes. That's the way the teeth gnashes. That's the way the gravy stains. That's the way the moon wanes.